Terri Griffith, thank you very much for taking the time for this interview.
You're very welcome.
On your website, you state that 20th century's thinking and practices may hold back an effective use of open innovation. How can companies overcome this kind of 20th century thinking?
How to break down boundaries is, as I'm sure you know, one of the most difficult things. So we've built buildings that actually have walls. And because they have walls, we think the people who do the work of the organization need to be inside those walls. And yet, we know that's not the way things happen anymore. We have people working all over the globe. And so I think it's necessary that we take kind of a stop, look, listen moment and say, are we doing these things because it's still the right way to do it? Or are we doing them because we've just done it that way in the past? And we have so much more flexibility than we did in the 20th century or the 19th century or going back. And so starting really from a fresh perspective, having past rules or copying a document that we've used for 10 years, so much better if we start from scratch and really say, what is it we need to be doing? And what's the most effective way for us to get there, given all the tools and resources we have today?
There's a lot of discussion about silos in companies and how to break down these silos. Mm-hmm. But do we have to break down the boundaries of companies as well?
I'm going to say we already are breaking down some of the boundaries of the companies. I've done some work on freelancers and gig workers, helping people think about quick transitions between jobs. You know, if someone says, well, I want to have traditional employees because then I can train them and I can spend all this effort on them and they can come to know my organization. But if we look at the data and see that people are transitioning out of organizations, maybe some of these places have a 50% turnover rate, are they really traditional employees even when you're paying them that way? Or are they really gig workers that are coming and going? So maybe what we do is we just think about the work of the organization and then step back and say, how do we need to get that work done? Is there anything that requires a traditional employment contract? Or do I start from scratch and think about, well, it could be automated. It could be a traditional employee. It could be a contract worker. It could be a freelancer. It could be some combination of those things. Really thinking maybe a portfolio approach, as one of my colleagues likes to talk about it.
In Austria, where I come from, and in Europe, there has been a strong transition from traditional employment contracts to freelancing. Mm-hmm. People on the one hand became much more flexible. On the other hand, they lost the feeling of belonging. Mm-hmm. What are the negative consequences of breaking down the boundaries?
Long ago, we didn't work as traditional employees. We were all freelancers. And in that instance, a lot of the education that we needed to do happened through guilds. And so the idea that I could belong to a guild, and the guild is my kind of professional association, I stay with them for my entire career, I can belong there, but still do the work of many different organizations. And that might be more interesting for some. Other people may just want to stay with that one organization and maybe they make a different choice. But I don't know that we've examined all the ways to overcome some of the negative things that seem to happen. I think the negative things may be because, going back to the earlier question about kind of 20th century approaches, if we try and maintain those 20th century approaches into this century, that's when you're going to see the negative things, because things don't quite fit anymore.
How are profits, losses, and risks distributed between mm-hmm. employees and companies? Mm-hmm. So the more you work with freelancers, the more you put the economic risk on the shoulder of the freelancer.
Right, right.
So does this breaking down boundaries also mean to break down the boundaries of profits, a different kind of profit sharing
mm-hmm.
then?
Mm-hmm. When I talk to people about guild structures, modern guild structures, they will say you could imagine different kinds of guilds, where maybe one guild is kind of eat what you kill, And so, you know, you raised a lot of money, you're going to get a lot of money. Other guilds could have more of a social services focus where part of the money that you make, you do contribute back to the guild, and that kind of can protect someone who doesn't have a gig at the moment.
In your book, The Plugged-In Manager, mm-hmm. you highlight that managers have to connect to people, technology, and organizational processes at the same time. Mm-hmm. Could you give me some examples how managers succeeded and developed effective business solutions by being plugged in?
I think the aspect is there's a contrast with people who take a silver bullet approach. So sometimes when I see a failure, I see that someone tried to implement a particular technology, but they didn't change anything else. Or they tried to implement a particular organizational practice, but they didn't change anything else. And I like to use the US in the late 70s, early 80s, when they said, the Japanese are using Teams. We should use Teams too. And so even to this day, many US organizations have said, you're in a team, but it's not really a team. It's just a group of people who work for the same boss. Or you're in a team, and maybe we even expect it to be a true team, but we still pay you as an individual. Or I have a class, and I have a team approach, a team project in my class, but I say, I need to force all of you onto a grading curve. And so if you're helping your classmate, you may be getting that person a better grade and hurting yourself. So these things have to be aligned. And so in cases where we align the human talent, the technologies, and the organizational techniques, and we make it all work in a way that is blended effectively, then things are great.
So being plugged in into people, technology, and organizational processes requires quite different skills.
It does.
How can managers acquire these skills?
What we found in some research, and so we did both the Plugged In Manager book, but at the same time we were collecting data around this idea of system savvy. System savvy we see as a capability that you or I can have, and we can have different levels of it. Some people automatically, for whatever reason in their experience, always are thinking about the human, the technical, and the organizational, and you'll see them do that. But when we look at their background, it's often the case that they've had a broad background. We've found that it doesn't seem to matter what experience level the person has. It really depends on kind of the reflection that they've done around whatever experience they do have. So we had people in their early 20s, but they had had very broad experiences growing up, and so they just naturally had learned this capability. Others had had educational backgrounds. You know, engineers like to talk about a T-shaped person or a T-shaped skill set. I like to talk about a triangle skill set a little bit more, but across the top of the T is the breadth of things that they've thought or worked in. And then the depth of that T being the experience they have maybe in electrical engineering or a particular piece of electrical engineering. But the fact that they've had those broad experiences has helped them develop an understanding that the human, the technical, and the organizational all need to be managed. And it's not necessarily that they're equal.
As I'm not a native English speaker, I had to look up for the term savvy. And I found synonyms such as understanding, intelligence, knowledge, but also common sense mm-hmm. and the ability to make good judgments. Is all of this included as you coined the term system savvy?
I think there's two pieces to that phrase. The systems piece, being really clear that it's not just a technology system, that's been something that we've had to often clarify, is that, oh, you mean computer systems? And we're like, no, that's one piece, but we mean systems of all the human, the technical, and the organizational. And then on the savvy side, you know, I want to say wisdom, but I don't think it has to be that extreme. So maybe understanding is the foundational piece of it, that I have an understanding, I have some savvy around the fact that this will be a multidimensional process and that we've got to find a way to mix those dimensions together. And that kind of gets me to the system savvy part. The other thing I like about it is it does make people stop and think, which may be the kind of trigger that we need, because all of us probably have an expertise in one of those three. So all of us, no matter how much system savvy we have, probably have to overcome a little bit of jumping to that initial conclusion and really taking that step back, or the stop, look, listen moment I mentioned, and seeing what are my actual opportunities.
To my experience, systems approaches are super effective for analysis, mm-hmm. but quite weak for management.
When I think about changes that fail, they often are not failures of the idea. The idea was fantastic. They're failures in the implementation. And so maybe someone was an organizational specialist, so they came up with the best process ever, technology specialist, best technology ever. But it really took system savvy for them to understand that it's worth bearing the cost of effective implementation. There was a book, and I wish I could ever find this book again, that said implementation is the unsexy afterthought of adoption. So you get all the credit for the great idea, and then maybe you get promoted and everyone else is left to do the hard work of the implementation. Someone who's system savvy knows that that is not, you're not done with the adoption. I like to think about it as this iterative, I'm going to stop, look, listen. I'm going to maybe negotiate. I like to think about negotiated change. It's any kind of a change is a negotiated process. And then I'm going to share the outcomes so that everybody else can help me think about starting that process all over again. May not be the fastest, or maybe it is, right? Because it might take me a lot longer to implement something poorly, have to start all over again, versus implementing something iteratively, taking small bites, which we know is a better strategy anyway, taking those small bites, doing some iteration, and we get to the long run outcome, maybe sooner, I expect certainly with less cost and with a lot more commitment around all the folks who've helped get us to this point.
Let's have a closer look at your understanding of the term system in system savvy. Mm-hmm. So what is a system?
Anything of those three dimensions, and the three dimensions are certainly a simplification. You know, if I have 10 weeks in a course, I'll talk about five dimensions maybe. If I go back and I look at a Galbraith star model maybe, or a McKinsey 7S, I've got more dimensions. But I think for most of us, we can really break it down into even three again. And I'll repeat myself a little bit that I have a target, and I have a set of talent available, I have a set of techniques, and I have a set of tools or technologies, and that system, and there's probably multiple gradations across each of those three, and I'll have students even map them out on like a radar graph and say, you know, do it with three, now do it with six, do it with nine, and force them to kind of break down the different pieces. But it's those interrelationships among those different dimensions that I think about as the system.
Do you have a closer look on the system's dynamics as well? So the interrelations between the components, let's say feedback loops and something like mm-hmm. that?
Well, there's the feedback loop, certainly in terms of the iterative approach to the design and the implementation. But I think you also get to respond to some of the dynamics if you do think about things as a negotiation, because even in that process, that give and take, I think speaks a little bit to the dynamic component of it. And if I take the stakeholders, and maybe there's, you know, one other stakeholder, maybe there are five other stakeholders or many more, that is another way that I can incorporate those ideas. That I can be sure that we are hitting on broader issues that would be beyond any one of our expertise.
What kind of tools do you apply to make people aware of the fact that they are part of a system?
Having those moments of reflection, I mean, and I know there are people who have far more complex and nuanced approaches, but even just having someone map out, or even using an Excel spreadsheet where I say, write down all your stakeholders. And I do make them do this in this order for the first pass. Write down your stakeholders. And they do that. I say, be generous. You know, think about even stakeholders that you might not include in the process, but you know that they will be impacted by some of the outcomes. So do that. Then start thinking about the high-level issues. And certainly start with, I know there's some technology issues, I know there's some technique issues, I know there's some talent ones. Write down some more of those and keep, you know, brainstorming around those different issues. And you can see this is very much a traditional negotiated approach, what I'm going to prepare for a negotiation. I want to know who my stakeholders are, what issues do they care about, what possible outcomes there could be within each of those issues, how much value do each of us gain from that particular answer. And once I've done all that, again, brainstorming, now I'm really prepared to even start having the conversations with those other stakeholders and adjusting my misperceptions. Because I will have not gotten right what your values are, you know, what you really want out of this deal, and I'm going to have to keep honing in on the truth of that matter. That, I think, is a practice that helps people come to see where they sit in the system and that other people's beliefs and values and desires are really going to be important to the outcome of it.
There are a few upcoming technologies that might be game changers: artificial intelligence, big data, Internet of Things. Mm-hmm. On the one hand, they will increase complexity. On the other hand, they promise to help us to deal with complexity. Mm-hmm. Do you think they are part of the solution or part of the problem?
I think how we implement them will be a huge kind of way of understanding if it's a solution or a problem. I've been writing a little bit recently, I did a blog post today about if I do it top down, so if artificial intelligence, for example, is implemented top down in an organization, I think then you're far more likely to get kind of the doom and gloom, workers being replaced by automation kinds of outcomes, versus if we find ways, and this is partially on the people developing the artificial intelligence tools, if we find ways to let the individual employees, the individual workers, come to build their own tools or find ways to augment their own work from the bottom up, if we do that, then I think, you know, you're going to get pluses and minuses across the board, but you're going to get such a much broader set of possibilities, of new inventions, of designs that will have great opportunities for augmenting work. So how do we help people position themselves to take advantage, kind of like when personal computers came on the scene? And when they got to the price point where you could buy one because you wanted to check this thing out, and then you had middle schoolers through retirees all trying out new things with their computers, that's when things took off, is we had so many inputs around the possibilities of how we could use that tool. I would like us to not keep AI as something that the company owns or the company implements, but to find a way that they become tools that all of us can use. So if we start using Siri more, Alexa more, pick your, you know, Google Home, if we start using those as individuals, will that trigger our own thinking such that we all are working towards coming up with good solutions versus a few kind of big corporate perspectives on it that I don't think will be as likely to be good for all of us?
What kind of framework conditions do we need that empower us, that allow us to take over control?
Mm-hmm. I would like to see the AI tools or the big data tools coming down to where they're more accessible to everyone, more drag and drop. At the same time, we as individuals have never really had to process map our work. And so until we do that, we might not be in a good position to even think about, wow, this is a place where if I automated it, then that would be so much easier for me and I could do these other things that I really like to do more. But we haven't included in the educational process, how do you think about doing the work that you're doing, unless you're kind of an automation engineer or you're a job designer or an HR person. Those people might have that skill set. But I think the way it's working, if we want it to be empowering to all, we all need to have that kind of ability to break down our work and to say, I could do this differently and do this other thing. As I think about AI, and I think the AI actions are going to come on us far more quickly than people expect, that the top-down approach is a problematic one, and I at least want there to be bottom-up action at the same time, and then I think we can sort out how these things work.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.